guys. So I want to talk today about machine gun usage and I guess proper machine gun usage, but also the realities of machine gun usage. I think anybody who's watched a lot of movies or even YouTube videos and things like that, we have a very skewed reality or a skewed perspective on what machine guns actually do and what they're actually good at and bad at. So first off, I'm going to kind of work through a little bit of machine gun vocabulary or a little bit of composition. So first thing, when we're talking about machine guns, the beating zone. So if we're shooting a pistol or a rifle, we would talk about our grouping. If we're shooting a shotgun with birdshot or buckshot, we'd talk about our pattern. So for machine guns, it's a beating zone. So for example, if I fire off a 9 to 12 round burst, where the rounds hit, so that area, that is the beating zone. So obviously, the more rounds fired in a given burst of fire, and the greater distance that the rounds are fired at, the larger the beating zone is going to be, okay? So then, rates of fire. All right, so rates of fire vary from machine gun to machine gun, so I'm not going to lay them out specifically, but first we have cyclic. So the cyclic rate of fire is the mechanical speed at which the particular machine gun can fire at. So for example, the M240 Golf, which is what we used when I was in the Marine Corps, had three rates of fire, 650 to 750, 750 to 850, and 850 to 950. Those were the, based on the gas setting, so those were the cyclic rates of fire. If you just held the trigger down with unlimited source of ammunition for 60 seconds and timed it, that's what you would hit, that many rounds. In addition to that, so we have rapid and sustained. So rapid fire is typically reserved for a fairly short amount of time, but obviously a high rate of fire. So usually, 1 to 2 minutes of rapid fire. You could think of this as just all out immediate suppression on something or firing down a final protective fire, last ditch, need to fire a lot of rounds. So anything, more than, about 200 rounds per minute as a rate is going to be rapid fire, which means that depending on the type of gun you have, you're going to have to change out the barrel. You're going to go through a lot of ammunition. So obviously these have to be fairly short periods of time. Then we have the sustained rate of fire. So sustained is exactly what it sounds like. So the sustained rate is a rate of fire that you can maintain for a particularly long amount of time, whether in defensive or offensive operations, potentially minutes and minutes and minutes. So, 5 to 10 minutes to 20 minutes of sustained fire. There will be barrel changes in there if we're going, especially from a defensive position or from a more established position or more formal position. Or there will have to be, fairly prevalent breaks in the fire. Okay, then there's two main types of impact or two main types of fire that a machine gun will control its beating zone with or its sector of fire with. So the first is grazing fire. Okay, so the actual definition of grazing fire is firing as such that the center of the beaten zone or the center of the cone of fire is centered 1 meter off the ground. So what you can think is 1 meter off the ground is roughly belly button or waist height on me. Centered means that my beaten zone is roughly nipples to knees. Okay, so if you think about what a grazing fire does, is it's extremely good across fairly flat ground and it covers a ton of depth. So if you think about firing 1 meter off the ground, all right, that covers people standing up, people who are prone, who are kneeling, who are in trenches or in fighting holes and they pop their heads out. But it also means that now my machine gun, my beaten zone, potentially covers hundreds of yards in depth. So not just the guy who's right in front of me, but the guys to the rear and behind him. So grazing fire is a very, very effective and very typical type of fire for machine gun. And then plunging fire. So plunging fire is what you typically think of. Plunging fire is where the round actually impacts. All right, so especially when there's undulations in the terrain or if we're shooting at buildings and things like that. So where the rounds are actually impacting and I'm trying to get my rounds to actually hit on this particular area, that is plunging fire. Okay, two very different methods, but both are very useful. Okay, so now a little bit about team composition. Okay, so depending, and this is totally different from the type of machine gun and the country and the period of time that we're talking about. So typically a machine gun is going to be 3 to 5 or 3 to 6. In the modern era, it's 3 guys. So you're going to have a gunner who carries the gun, who's responsible for the actual operation of the weapon itself. You're going to have an assistant gunner who does exactly what you think he does. He helps change the barrels. He helps load and feed and prep ammo and make sure that there's ammo in the gun. He helps clear any malfunctions. He helps set the gun up and all those sort of things. You have an ammo carrier who does exactly what you think. He carries ammo and things like that. You have a gun team leader, all right, who does exactly what you think he does, like a fire team leader for a regular infantry. He controls where the gun is laid, the actual sector of fire, it's assigned to fire, and the operation of his gun, meaning the rate of fire, the targets selected, how they're traversing, things like that. He's responsible for the lay of that gun, as we would say. Okay, and then I get over here. So there's three main types of machine gun: light, medium, and heavy. They all have their basic usages, and in the modern era, they all kind of get combined sometimes. So a light machine gun typically is one man portable, all right, and it is carried with an assaulting element, which is meant to give the squad immediate abilities of a machine gun, but it's light. So obviously it's more portable, it traverses a little bit better, it's easier to carry, but that means it cannot carry as much ammo because the guy's not going to have as many people in his gun team. It's typically, for us, it's the M249, the M27 IAR. So it's a lighter caliber, so obviously cannot put down the volume of fire that a medium or heavy machine gun can. Medium machine gun is typically squad and platoon level, which means it's going to have much more ammo, it's going to have much more focus around it. It is not nearly as portable, but it has more abilities of sustained fire and suppressive fire. And in terms of the Marine Corps and in terms of America, for us it's the M240 series, which means it has more range because it's a 7.62 NATO, thus more penetrating power. It's more effective in the brush, in the fields, things like that. Then you have the heavy machine gun. So for the most part, a heavy machine gun is, in the modern era, it's typically vehicle mounted or mounted on aircraft, things like that. Or it's in a static defensive position. It can be man portable, but nobody likes to carry that shit. Historically, especially in World War II, we talk a lot about the German gun teams. They carried a GPMG, a general purpose machine gun, in the MG42. And when set up on the Lafayette tripod and in a defensive position, it served the heavy machine gun role, but it was very capable on the bipod and with an assault pack on it, so it could serve the medium machine gun role. So again, it could do multiple things. Guys, we just talked about some of the vocabulary words or the things that make machine gun speak. So now, we're going to kind of some general strengths and weaknesses of machine guns. Okay, so starting over here with strengths. So first thing we got is VOF, volume of fire. Kind of obvious, but what makes the machine gun, so valuable is that this one weapon system puts out enough fire to replace numerous members of a given squad, fire, team, platoon, whatever, which then means that A, the element's total amount of volume of fire they can put out goes up, but it also means it frees up personnel to do other tasks, whether defending or attacking. It means that they can, you know, operate other weapon systems. It means that you can just cover more area with more fire. So volume of fire. Okay, then suppression and isolation. All right, so I listed those together because suppression and isolation is the mission of the machine gun in the urban environment. All right, but one, I want to talk, suppression is one of those things that gets thrown out there, and I think very few people actually have a good understanding of what it means. Typically, you hear suppressive fires when you hear people talking reactions to contact. They say, oh, we want to get fire superiority, so it's more rounds going out than rounds coming in, which is fucking wrong. It can't be that way, all right? So there has to be an accuracy and an effectiveness component to suppression, or it is not suppression. So an easy example is, if you're seeing this video, you've probably seen a lot of videos online, there's a ton of them from the Global War on Terror, of Allied troops, American troops, under fire, and they are being effectively suppressed. You can hear the snap of the rounds, you can hear the whiz of the rounds, so it's having some form of effect on their accuracy or their effectiveness or their willingness to go into certain positions. But you can also see a lot of times return fire that is either wild, erratic, or directed at very large areas and somewhat unaimed or wasteful. And then you can also see the reverse of that. So you can see enemy videos they've taken where they're under fire in these situations, and you can hear a lot of rounds coming in, but you can tell it's not particularly accurate, and so it doesn't really have a noticeable effect on these guys. If you know your enemy is firing wildly at you, or if the rounds are just hitting near you, it doesn't have that much of an effect. I don't say this in I'm super tough or like a bragging way, but once you've been in a firefight or a few firefights, just the sound of rounds somewhat close does not have the same effect on you as rounds that are directed at you individually. There's definitely a difference. Okay? Then isolation. All right, so isolation. So hugely important task of the machine gun. So if we want to use an example of isolation in the urban environment, let's say we have enemies in this particular building, so we want to isolate it. So one, we isolate it so that people on the outside can't get in, so they can't reinforce them, bring them more ammo, all that sort of stuff, and we isolate so that people inside can't get out. So a couple reasons we might want to do that. One, we might want to assault the building because there's intelligence or personnel that we want to capture or kill inside. We might want to suppress it so nobody can get out of there. That way we can hit it with artillery, with a tank, or with air power, things like that. So combined arms. So if we isolate a particular objective, it becomes much easier to attack it or to suppress it or to in some other way prosecute that. Okay, so suppression and isolation, huge. I've got AOA, avenues of approach. Avenues of approach is what machine guns do. And people need to fucking know this, all right? So when we set up a machine gun, it always is set up to cover an avenue of approach, which is a road, which could be a trail, or it can be a more accessible area within a given amount of terrain. Let's say, for example, I live out in the hills, so I'm up on a hill and I'm overlooking somewhat just dirt, open terrain. It's muddy right now, it's snowing, it's tough to get through, but this one particular area is kind of rocky or maybe slightly elevated, and it can handle foot traffic better, or maybe it can handle vehicle traffic. That is an avenue of approach, and that must be controlled. All right? And the reason is obvious. One, if we can attack or destroy or in some way disable enemy vehicles, that's huge. But also, if we think about defending an area, if this particular area over here is the easiest way for the enemy to approach us, it means he can cover the ground faster and get on top of us faster. Whereas if we can control that, either one, he'll have to break his attack off potentially, or it means he has to go through areas that's going to take longer. So it's time when they're under fire from our machine guns, under fire from our rifles, our grenades, our mortars, our artillery, our air power. All right, so it's all done in conjunction. Machine guns control avenues of approach. That is freaking it, man. All right, and then along with that, terrain control. So we kind of touched on that with everything else. All right, but if we want to control a particular thing, a particular terrain feature, or a particular area, that's what machine guns do. They set up, they cover a sector of fire. They have what's called a final protective fire in a defense, which means no matter what, they can set themselves to that FPF, as it's called. They can fire an assigned rate, and they can control, which typically an avenue of approach, with their rate of fire. All right, so they can control terrain. So now, getting into weaknesses over there. So the first two are kind of, you know, I guess they're all kind of combined. So we talk about point targets. Machine guns are not particularly great at engaging individual point targets. And it's not because they're inherently inaccurate. Machine guns are still very accurate weapons. But one, if you're firing a long burst, then obviously your accuracy is going to go down. Just the same as if I, you know, was firing a 5, 6, 7 round group with my pistol at close range, I would start to open up a little bit. And traversing speed and beating zone size play into that, all right? So machine guns are bigger and they're heavier than rifles, than assault rifles, you know, than our carbines, everything like that, obviously. And so they do not traverse particularly fast from side to side, all right? And the beating zone size, as I already talked about, the longer the burst or the farther the distance, the larger that beating zone gets. So for example, if I have one lone target at 1,200 meters, all right, it's extremely difficult to prosecute that guy with a machine gun. It would be very difficult to prosecute that with an SPR, an accurized rifle designed for that type of fire, so let alone with a machine gun. However, at that distance, the beaten zone is quite large, but if we walk the beaten zone onto an area we want to suppress, it can still be very effective. That's what machine guns do. Okay, so to kind of dispel a few myths with that, when it comes to traversing, you know, obviously, especially if a machine gun is laid into a tripod, it only has a limited traverse, 300 mils. It can't go that far, but machine guns are longer and heavier. And so whenever you see in movies guys traversing wildly side to side and engaging enemies, machine guns, they do not do that. I mean, one, you would rarely ever do that, even if presented with the situation. That's why you have additional members of the unit. But they're just not good at it. And you can see that really famous movie, All Quiet on the Western Front, which is one of the best war movies of all time. There's a famous scene, one of the first attacks where the French attacked their trenches, and you can see the guy on his Maxim MGO. It's an MGO-8, always stands out. It's got that big toggle lock on the right side, and that sucker's just flopping back and forth, and you see him just traversing side to side and just mowing dudes down. Great scene, especially the MGO-8. That's not at all how that was used. If you watch actual videos of World War I and you see machine gunners, they're holding that spade trigger down, and you can see their whole body shaking. They called it the devil's paintbrush, and these guys were artists for a reason. Whole body shaking. You'll see them every so often. They'll reach up and they'll swat the side of that machine gun with the palm of their hand. And so what they're doing is they're moving the machine gun on the traversing and elevation mechanism just a little bit. It's staying within their sector of fire, but they are moving it just a little bit while they cover their sector. He's not picking out point targets. He's covering his area. All right? That is what machine guns do. Okay. Then the last two, weight and then size and equipment, are all kind of combined. So obviously, the bigger the machine gun, the heavier it is, the less easy to wield that it is. So for example, M240 Golf, M240 Bravo, awesome medium machine gun, great at the squad or platoon level, you wouldn't want it in CQB. It's not designed for that. It's long, it's heavy, it weighs 26.6 pounds, it sucks. Then the equipment that goes with it, so spare barrel, tripod potentially, if we have thermals or other optics, they're larger, and if we have thermals and we need batteries, the batteries are big. We have the A bag that goes with it. Ammo, obviously we need a lot of ammo, and if we're talking the 240 series or the MG42, we're talking things like that. We're talking a heavier caliber, so the ammo itself weighs more. We typically talk 7 pounds for 100 rounds of 7.62 NATO, or 7 pounds for 200 rounds of 5.56 NATO. Not saying one's better than the other, they both have their place. But so don't get machine guns confused with weapons that are designed for a specific purpose. Machine guns are extremely good at what they were designed for, primarily terrain control, volume suppression, and controlling of a specific sector of fire and a particular FPF. They do not traverse particularly fast, they do not engage point targets particularly fast, but they are absolutely integral part of any unit operation, whether we're talking light, medium, or heavy machine guns, okay? So again, just putting out knowledge, guys, we can always talk about this in the comments, so remember, only the hits count, and you can never miss fast enough to catch back up.